welcome to worship on this Lord's Day. It's a glorious one. It is. A couple quick announcements. I will be at Knox County Nursing Home this Thursday for a 2 o'clock service. As they say, Lord willing, and the creek don't rise. We offer our condolences to Chris and Dave Johnson. Chris's dad passed away this week. His name was Jim. Jim Hannafin. So we offer our condolences. Other announcements? Further in the service, we will be welcoming Marissa Jo Lynn Waldorf through the sacrament of holy baptism. We are so excited to be calling you our sister. So hold on for that part of this service. I'd like to invite Pastor Bob Clark to come up and give us a few words.
I've been looking forward to sharing with you some of my thankfulness about being here. A little over 3 years ago, when Pastor Pam talked to Amber and me and asked Amber if she would consider being the organist here, we knew Pam Marola as a musician friend. We didn't know her as Pastor Pam. She was a musician friend. And my first impression was gothic gloomy. And the organ was an absolute wreck. But Amber and I had been away from Lutheran liturgical worship for way too long, and we were really eager to be coming back into this kind of worship. And so we said yes, and shortly after that, the organ did die, a rather loud death, and we purchased this state-of-the-art Allen organ, which I absolutely love, and I love the organist too very much. And we have a totally refurbished Steinway grand piano. So these wonderful instruments generate thankfulness to me. They really help us worship. And gothic gloomy has turned into sacred space for me. Sacred space aglow with the Holy Spirit. It's not gloomy at all. I marvel at the architecture. I marvel at the 3-second reverberation when I play my horns or sing. I marvel at these doors. Hawkinson Manufacturing, an engineering miracle in those doors to Parish Hall. So, lots of physical things. I see generations of caring in the architecture and in the care of this building and grounds. And I'm thankful for Amber Clark and Bob Fornander and Dan Randall and Izzy Garcia, and for the talent and skill and the care that they give us and add so much value to what this church is about. So our musician friend Pam Marola has become our beloved Pastor Pam. And I am so grateful and thankful for good sermons, excellent teaching, genuine caring ministry, and really fine administrative skills. Pastor Pam, I think you're the best, and I thank you. I thank you. Yes. I'm also very thankful for the committee structure of this congregation. You know, 99% of the work is done by the committees. And I serve on the Worship and Music Committee, and I serve on the Building and Grounds Committee. And then each of the committees really does the work and makes some decisions. And then the church council that I'm on serves as a clearinghouse for those, for all that work and the final vote of approval or modification. And so last Tuesday night we had a council meeting. It lasted a whole 35 minutes. The work had been done. And I can say committees, I mean you, all of us. This is the most most active church I've ever been involved in terms of the membership, and I give thanks for that. I give thanks for our food pantry. This outreach ministry is just marvelous. We've helped so many people who are food insecure in our community, and it's just an honor to be part of that. I like the concept of God's work, our hands. I like it that we're a Matthew 25 church. Everyone is welcome here, really welcome. I like the accent on grace, which we will see especially in the baptism this morning, accented grace. So when I consider, when Amber and I consider our pledge for 2022, we think about time, talent, and treasure, and we go to our thank yous. And if our pledge this year is going to be the minimum guarantee, unless disaster hits our household, the minimum guarantee that we will give, that the church can count on, and if we can give more, we certainly will. But it comes out of our thank you. And so I ask you, as you consider what you're going to give to the church next year, get into your thank you, and it'll be like seeds planted on fertile soil, and your giving will bear good fruit. Amen. And thank you.
Much gratitude for you, Bob, for Amber, and for all of you. Truly, God has brought us together in this place. Let's rise for the gathering again.
We
God, whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter, like lost sheep,
we have gone astray.
We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity.
We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression.
We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed.
Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. We all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous, righteous, righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins.
Amen. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Sovereign God, you turn your greatness into goodness for all the people of earth. Shape us into willing servants of your kingdom, and make us desire always and only your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from Hebrews. Every high priest, chosen from among mortals, is put in charge of things pertaining to God on their behalf, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is subject to weakness. And because of this, he must offer sacrifice for his own sins, as well as for those of the people. And one does not presume to take this honor, but takes it only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also, Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he also says in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to Jesus and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I baptize with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must become your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Do you have any memories of sibling squabbles in the back seat of a vehicle with mom and dad up front? Maybe it was your own siblings as children, or maybe your own kids, grandkids, nieces, nephews. "He's touching me. She's looking at me." That kind of stuff. This is kind of what I imagine when I read today's gospel. Okay? Imagine 12 disciples in the back of a 15-passenger van and Jesus is driving. You get that one? James and John coming up to Jesus and saying, "We want to be first. We want to be at the right hand and the left hand." And the other disciples get mad at them because they thought of it first. But this passage from Mark today, the beginning of the actual passage, begins with Jesus telling the disciples for the third time that he will be arrested and killed. Still, the disciples don't get it. The disciples have seen Jesus in action, healing and teaching and feeding, miracles. They have left their family and home to follow him, literally to walk with him. Why might they not understand or acknowledge what Jesus is saying about his arrest and death? The Jewish people at that time were looking for a savior, a messiah, someone from the line of David, someone promised in the book of Isaiah, who would bring them liberation. And Jesus is making all the right moves, saying all the right things. Surely he must be amassing an army to overthrow the Roman occupiers. Once again, Israel might be great and free and ruled by the people who fear and worship God. But we know, and the disciples were not ready to admit, that the freedom that Jesus was offering was not freedom from Roman occupiers. Jesus was not preparing an army of warriors to take on the might of Rome. Jesus was preparing the way for a new kingdom, one that was so different to the current systems of the world that it was hard to see what it might be like. James and John, brothers, asked Jesus if they could sit at his left and right in the new kingdom. And traditionally, those who sit next to the king or the leader were the powerful people. It was a place of great honor. When you're at an event, maybe a wedding, who sits at the head table? The bride, the groom, the honored ones, and then the bests, the people they treasure the most, and then their parents. Who sits in the back corner? the left and right of Jesus will actually be those who were crucified with him. Then Jesus tells the disciples again that those who are great are those who serve. This new way of living, the way of Jesus, does not follow the ways of Rome or any other empire. Honor and status is not about wealth or prestige or number of slaves you own. Being great is not about the size of your army, but the way you serve, the way you live for others. Again, I'm preaching to the choir because you understand service. Then this final sentence of our reading, the Son of Man did not come to be a slave master, but a slave who will give his life to rescue many people. There's a writer who's a specialist in the Gospel of Mark, Chip Myers. He writes, the term ransom refers to the price required to redeem captives or purchase freedom for indentured servants. Jesus promised then that the way of servanthood had been transformed by the human one, the Son of God, the Son of Man, transformed into a way of liberation. Not from Rome, but from powers bigger than Rome. How long has it been since our lives changed so dramatically due to COVID? Is it 18, 19, 20 months, something like that? This is the first time I'm wearing my robe in worship since March of 2020. Since then, sometimes we've been able to meet, sometimes we've not, sometimes masked, sometimes singing, and at times we've not been able to visit family and friends. We've missed birthdays and funerals. And we're still returning, yearning to return to something that we used to call normal. But what is normal? Like James and John, we do what humans do best. We fall back on what we know, what's comfortable, how the world always worked. We hope and pray that the world has not and will not change as much as it already has and as much as we know that it will. What once was is not working anymore. We know that deep in our hearts and souls. God is perhaps calling us to a new thing. The world around us is changing. And if we lean on our own intuitions, it feels chaotic, out of control, confusing, frustrating. For James and John, they've heard Jesus talk three times now about his impending death. And I imagine they may have been confused as well. Their idea of Messiah does not include death. That just doesn't make sense. Jesus is simply affirming here what the world does to those who put their trust in love and follow it through in every aspect of their lives. The disciples are fixated on the reward for their actions. But that is not what is significant. It's the ability to trust, to love, to live it out in the world. That's the right response. points out so clearly over and over and over again. Take the time to read the Gospel of Mark. It's the shortest gospel. It's 16 chapters. Read how often the disciples miss the mark. The kind of power they seek is the very power that will have Jesus crucified. I'm going to say that one more time. The power that the disciples were seeking. And sometimes we get caught up in that train too. The power they were seeking is the very power that would have Jesus crucified. Once Jesus enters Jerusalem, the world will change. But we live on the other side of the cross and the empty tomb, and still, when we don't have answers or there doesn't seem to be any answer in the immediate future, our human pattern is to power and partner with power, rather than to hold hands with humility. I didn't come up with that line. I don't know who said it first, but our human pattern is to partner with power rather than to hold hands with humanity. That's not the way of Jesus. I'm one of those people who wants the answers. I want to know what's going to happen. I want to be able to plan and not have those plans changed by COVID or aging or ill health or anything else. I'm human. I want the security of knowledge. But Jesus asks us to trust in the power of love. This morning, we're going to celebrate the baptism of Marissa. We're going to celebrate that through baptism, God called Jesus his son. Through baptism, God has called all of us children, brothers and sisters. We are to take care of each other and the world God has given us. And we're going to welcome Marissa because she's part of that world. And the world is a messy place. But today, we're going to celebrate that God claims her and that she's got lots of brothers and sisters who will help her wade through the messy stuff and trust in love. May the peace of God that passes all understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Receive the blessing. People of God, you are Christ's body bringing new life to a suffering world. The Holy Trinity, one God, bless you now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
for the service of holy baptism. In baptism, our gracious Heavenly Father frees us from sin and death by joining us to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are born children of a fallen humanity. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are reborn children of God and made members of the Church, the body of Christ. Living with Christ and in the communion of saints, we grow in faith, love, and obedience to the will of God. Marissa, called by the Holy Spirit and trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to be baptized into Christ? Called by the Holy Spirit, trusting in the grace and love of God. Lisa, as you bring this child to receive the gifts of baptism, you are entrusted with responsibilities to live with her among God's faithful people, to bring her to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, to teach her the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, to place in her hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture her in faith and prayer, so that she may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world God made, and to work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help Marissa to grow in the Christian faith and life?
I do.
We continue with the profession of faith on page 229. I ask you all to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the Church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God?
I renounce them.
Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God?
I renounce them.
Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters. And your word, by your word, you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. And through the sea, you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you set us free from the power of sin and death, and raise us up to new life in you. Pour out your Holy Spirit, the power of your living word, that those who are washed in the waters of baptism may be given new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Marissa, will you lean over the plant, please? I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be God. God, the source of all life, the word of salvation, the spirit of mercy. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give your daughters and sons new birth. Cleanse them from sin and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Marissa with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence both now and forever. Amen. Marissa, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen.
Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven.
Marissa, can you turn to the congregation? Let us welcome the newly baptized. We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world. Welcome, Marissa. We invite you to rise for the prayers.
Join me in praying for this community and for the world. Lord, our Heavenly Father, set free from sin and death, and nourished by the word of truth, we join in prayer for all of your creation. Holy One, for the gift of the church handed down through the ages, and for all who carry on the servant ministry of Jesus, we praise you. Send your Holy Spirit upon all who are discerning calls to ministry in its many forms, and equip them with your gifts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Creating One, for the lush and abundant habitat you provide for all your creatures, we praise you. Provide healing for the earth so that waterfowl, reptiles, wild horses, dolphins, and all living things flourish as you intend. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Suffering One, for all who work toward peace and who lead nations with a servant's heart, we praise you. Bring justice for all who suffer violence, persecution, discrimination, hunger, poverty, and homelessness, and create places of refuge for all people. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Merciful One, for all who do the work of healing in mind, body, and spirit, we praise you. Surround and comfort all who struggle with depression, anxiety, cancer, diabetes, dementia, or any illness, that all may be healed. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Sustaining One, for all who volunteer for the vitality of this congregation, we praise you. Strengthen and encourage ushers, volunteers, bakers, counters, committee leaders, teachers, students, evangelists, prayers, singers, builders, nurturers, and all who serve with generous hearts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Risen One, we thank you for those who have shaped your church and shared your gospel, especially Chris Johnson's father, James Hampton. Through the witness of your saints, continue to inspire us with hope until we are all gathered at your eternal feast. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Confident that you hear us, O God, we boldly place our prayers into your hands. Through Jesus Christ, our truth and life.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it for the disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We are gathered by the Holy Spirit, and so we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
All who hunger and thirst, come, the table is ready. This meal is hosted by our Lord Jesus himself and by his invitation. You are welcome.
Thank you so much for joining us for worship. We hope that you join us again next week at the same time.